Okay, so in the last video, we introduced the idea of a tensor, and now specifically, we're going to take a look at the moment of inertia tensor. So we'll start by considering angular momentum. All right, so if you remember, the angular momentum of some object is the sum over its particles, and I will use alpha to indicate the particles. I'll use letters like I, J, and K for our 1, 2, 3 indices for x, y, and z. So R alpha cross P alpha. Okay, super. So this will be the sum over alpha R alpha cross M alpha V alpha. But since we're by definition, that will also be sum over alpha R alpha cross M alpha omega cross R alpha, because we remember the identity V equals omega cross R. So we can pull the m through the sum, or through the product rather, m alpha. We have r alpha crossed into omega cross r alpha. And we can evaluate that cross product using the back cab rule. So that'll be sum over alpha m alpha r alpha squared. This is b, b times a dot c, so the b is omega here, minus cab c times, which will be r alpha, times a dot b, which is r alpha dotted with omega. All right, so now that we've taken our vector identities about as far as we can, I'm going to switch into using our summation indices. So we can write the ith component of L is equal to sum over alpha m alpha. Okay, so now when I pull out this omega, the ith component of it is going to be just omega I. Now this is r alpha dot r alpha. So that's going to be sum over, let's call it k, x alpha k squared. When we write it as tensors, we usually write our r's as x's. Don't know why, that's just usually what we do. Minus then we need the ith component of this, so that'll be x alpha I, like so. And then this dot product here will be a sum over something else, let's say it's j. Oops, x alpha j omega j. Okay. Certainly, we can go ahead and rewrite this to make this all on a sum over j by contracting indices here. So here's how we'll do that. We'll write that as sum over alpha m alpha. Then I'll write a sum over j. I still have my omega I here, but now I can write this as delta I j, right? And so then that gets that, that still picks out the ith component of omega. All right. I still have my sum over k x alpha k squared. Minus, so now here I'll pull my omega j through. The joy of playing with tensors is everything's a scalar, so you gotta love it. And so now with this sum over j, I can just pull, it's just gone because I threw in the Kronecker delta here, so I could sum everything over j. And so I have x alpha j, x alpha j. Like so. Okay. I can pull the sum over, I can interchange the order summation here, so I will. And I'm sorry, that should be an omega j right there, so that when I contract the Kronecker delta, I get an omega I. My apologies. So I have sum over j, omega j, sum over alpha, m alpha, delta I j, sum over k, x alpha squared k, minus, I'm sorry, here too, one of these should be an I. X alpha I, X alpha j. There we go. From here, I moved that in over there. Okay. Sorry about that. So now I'm left with X alpha I, X alpha j. All right. So if I look at the sum over j omega j bit, I realize that I'm just going to be taking everything here and dotting it into omega. So following that thought there, this would look, this, if we hold our nose and call this a moment of inertia, but it's a moment of inertia tensor. So we will define our moment of inertia tensor. I by the ij. So the ijth component will be sum over alpha m alpha delta ij sum over k x alpha k squared minus x alpha I x alpha j. Alright, so we can get some intuition for it. Let's go ahead and actually write this as a matrix. So we'll represent as a matrix just so we get some feel for it. So every term here is going to have a sum over alpha, m alpha. But now let's see what we get when we actually go ahead and pick out the pieces here. So right now I have the 1-1 component. So I look at that delta 1-1. Okay, delta 1-1 is 1. So I get a sum over k alpha x alpha squared k. So I'll have an x alpha 1-1, x alpha 2-2, x alpha 1 squared, x alpha 2 squared, x alpha 3 squared. And I'll be subtracting an x alpha 1, x alpha 1. So what I'm left with is x alpha 2 squared plus x alpha 3 squared. All right. Now for the next one here, so now we're on the 1-2 element, delta ij is 0, so this term doesn't contribute. So I'm just left with sum over alpha m alpha x alpha 1 x alpha 2. And then finally here, this is the 1-3 again, delta 1-3. 1 doesn't equal 3, so the Kronecker delta is 0. This term doesn't contribute, so I'm left with a minus sum over alpha m alpha x alpha 1 x alpha 3. All right. Now let's do row 2. This will be 2-1. Again, doesn't contribute. So I will have minus sum over alpha m alpha x alpha 2 x alpha 1. Now here, 2-2. Okay, this does contribute. So I will have here a 1-1, a 1-2, and a 1-3, and I'll be subtracting the 2-2. So I have here a sum over alpha m alpha x, x alpha 1 squared plus x alpha 3 squared. And then similarly here, we'll have a minus sum over alpha, alpha x alpha 2 x alpha 3. Then finally here, this is 3, 1, so this will be minus sum over alpha, alpha x alpha 3 x alpha 1 minus sum over alpha, whoops, over alpha m alpha x alpha 3 x alpha 2. And then finally, when I get to 3, 3, the Kronecker delta applies, so this term contributes. The 3, 3 will cancel, and I'm left with sum over alpha m alpha x alpha 1 squared plus x alpha 2 squared. Whew! Now, an important thing to note here is that this is a symmetric matrix, so ij equals ijI. You can see that, you know, 1, 2, 2, 1, but these are scalars, so scalar multiplication commutes. So everything here equals everything there. Okay, these things have names here, so let's follow it through. I'm first going to go through and highlight the main diagonal, like so. Everything on the main diagonal are the moments of inertia. Everything off diagonal, and they, oops, a little overzealous there. Everything off diagonal, and keep in mind it's symmetric, so there's only really three things, but it's just they're written twice. There we go. These things in orange here are the products of inertia, they're usually called. So, with this definition of the moment of inertia, we can write the angular momentum of something is equal to the moment of inertia tensor dotted into the angular momentum. Or if we're writing it in tensor notation, we'd say the ith component of L is equal to sum over j, ij, omega j. Those are two ways of writing the same thing. So this is a little different than what you've seen before. To date, we've treated the moment of inertia as a scalar in lower division mechanics. We'll see where we can still do that and when we can't. All right, so we've looked at the angular momentum. Now let's go ahead and look at the rotational kinetic energy of our system. All right, so recall from our treatment of non-inertial frames that dr prime dt, evaluating the fixed frame, because remember to do Newton's laws of motion, we got to do everything in the fixed frame, was equal to dr, the position vector of our non-inertial frame relative to the inertial frame, evaluating the fixed frame, plus dr dt, evaluating the rotating frame, plus omega cross r. All right, so we can write that then as the velocity of something measured in the fixed frame is equal to the velocity of the moving frame plus the velocity is measured in the rotating frame plus omega cross r. So now for a rigid body, which is what we're looking at here, we're going to be looking at some point mass that's undergoing rotation, right? That we're going to be doing this about the center of mass. We're going to put our coordinates at the center of mass, so we can go ahead and say that our VR is, which is dr dt, will be zero. All right. So for particle number alpha, we can write the velocity of particle alpha will be equal to big V plus omega cross r alpha. That's just because the position of, like I said, back to here, the position in the rotating frame, the position of our objects never changes. All right, so we remember that the kinetic energy of that particle, so the kinetic energy of that particle then is, we're going to say, is 1/2 m alpha v alpha squared. So the kinetic energy of everything is going to be the same thing, but now we have to throw in a sum over alpha. And now v alpha squared, remember, it's actually v alpha dot v alpha. And we'll put in what v alpha is. So 1/2 sum over alpha m alpha. And that will be big V plus omega cross r alpha dotted with itself. All right. So we can go ahead and FOIL out the dot product. So you're going to pick up a term 1/2 sum over alpha m alpha. We'll just get a V squared for the V dot V there. The cross term will have two of them. They'll cancel the half. So plus sum over alpha m alpha V dotted with omega cross R alpha. And then finally, the last term will have a 1/2 sum over alpha m alpha. And then here we'll have an omega cross r alpha. So this is plus there. I know I said it, I just wrote it bad. Omega cross r alpha squared. Alrighty. So usually we want to rotate about the center of mass. And if that's the case, this pesky cross term, I'll call that term 2, I contend that term 2 is equal to 0. Why is that? Think it through, and I'll get back with you. Okay, so the easiest way to see this one is to say that we can pull in the sum over alpha m alpha to inside the cross product and change nothing. So v dot omega cross sum over alpha m alpha r alpha. And we recognize that if we were to divide this through by the mass of the whole thing, that would be the position of the center of mass. But wait, that would be the position of the center of mass with respect to the center of mass, so that term is 0. All right. So, since we're rotating about our center of mass, we can then write that the kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared plus 1/2 sum over alpha m alpha omega cross r alpha squared. So we identify this as the translational kinetic energy and that as the rotational kinetic energy. Okay, we'll defer the translational bit for now and focus on the rotational bit. So we can write T rotational is 1 half sum over alpha m alpha. And remember, this squared here is just really saying you're dotting it with itself. So omega cross r dotted with omega cross r alpha. All right, now quick interlude here. Remember from way back in the day, we proved that A cross B dotted with itself is equal to A squared B squared minus A dot B squared. All right, so we'll go ahead and apply that identity. So we have T rotational is equal to 1/2 sum over alpha m alpha. So now this will become omega squared r alpha squared minus omega dot r alpha squared. All right, let's continue to expand that in our tensor notation. This is 1/2 sum over alpha m alpha. Remember, this is omega dot omega here. So we can write that as, as a sum over I omega I squared. For the R alpha, we can call it a sum over K X alpha K squared. And then we'll say minus. Now for this bit here, we have two separate dot products. So we're going to be saying this is equal to sum over I omega I x alpha I. Now I could just go ahead and say squared, but it'll be instructive to go ahead and say sum over j omega j x alpha j. No difference, but it's useful. All right, so we've got sums over I into j almost everywhere. I can turn this sum over I omega I squared into a sum over I and j individually if I throw in a Kronecker delta, so that is exactly what I'm going to do. So I now have 1/2 sum over alpha sum over I and j m alpha. So now this becomes omega I omega j delta I j. This is still times sum over k x alpha k squared. Oh, that just looks awful. X alpha k squared. All right, good. Minus omega I omega j. Since we pulled the sums through, we're all good there. Omega I omega j x alpha I x alpha j. Yay. All right, now everybody's got an omega I omega j, so we can pull that out into the sum. In fact, I'm going to move the sum over alpha in. So I'm going to have 1/2 sum over I, j, omega j, sum over alppha, m alpha, delta I, j, sum over k, x alpha, k squared, minus x alpha, I, x alpha, j. But hey, that much right there is our moment of inertia tensor. Yes. So I can write the rotational kinetic energy as 1/2 sum over I and j, IIJ omega I omega j. Or if I were writing that in vector notation, I would be writing this T rot equals 1/2 omega dot I dot omega. And we have to write it funky like this because remember, this is going to, evaluating I dot omega like this will give me a column vector, and then this is a row vector, and then finally I get a scalar. Yes, 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 strictly I know I should be pointing the arrowhead the other way because this is contravariant and this is covariant, but who cares, because it's a real, it's a Euclidean space, so we're all happy. All right. So now let's go take a look at continuous objects. Yes. So now that we've developed our relations for moments of inertia, if we've got some object with lots and lots and lots of molecules, we can go ahead and approximate that sum by replacing it with the appropriate integral. So then that becomes iij equals integral delta ij sum over k xk squared, there's no alphas anymore, minus xi xj dm. Let's do an example of that just to get a feel for it. So let's go ahead and find the moment of inertia matrix for a cube about a corner of the cube. So here's my coordinate axes, x1, x2, x3. Let's say the cube is of side length b. There we go. And we'll stick the origin at the origin. All right, so then to get my, let's go ahead and get my I11 entry. So this will be an integral dm x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared from the Kronecker delta part minus the x1 bit, so those cancel. Now I need to express my integral dm. It's going to become a triple integral. It's going to be the density times, now we're going to integrate from it's going to be the density, and then we're going to need a volume element. So we can get a volume element by integrating 0 to b. dx3 integral 0 to b dx2 integral 0 to b dx1 of x2 squared plus x3 squared. All right, so I can immediately evaluate this integral dx1. This is a constant with respect to that, so I could just pull that through the integral, and this just becomes b, so I get a rho b and then the remaining two integrals. All right, so let's evaluate the integral with respect to x2. So I'll have here rho b integral 0 to b dx3, and then x2 squared is going to become x2 cubed over 3, and the x3 squared is a constant, so we get plus x3 squared x2. I'll evaluate 0 to b on the x2. So this is going to become rho b integral 0 to b dx3. So the x2 cubed bit is going to become b cubed over 3 plus x3 squared b. All right, so I can pull a b out just to make it look a little cleaner. This will become rho b squared integral 0 to b dx3 of b squared over 3 plus x3 squared. All right, and then I can go ahead and do the integral over x3. It's going to become rho b squared. This is going to be b squared over 3 times x3, evaluated from, well, we'll just do it right. B squared over 3 times x3 plus x3 cubed over 3, evaluated from 0 to b. Whoops. So this will be the density b cubed, so b squared, times this will become b cubed over 3 plus, we pick up a another b cubed over 3 there. So this becomes 2/3 rho b to the fifth. But our density, so I11 equals our density is the mass of the whole thing over the volume, which is b cubed. So then I have 2/3 and a b to the fifth. So I finally get, I11 equals 2/3 mb. Squared. All right, and you should be able to convince yourself by the symmetry of the situation that this is also true for I22 and I33, so I'm just going to assert that to be the case. All right, now let's calculate one of the products of inertia. Turns out they'll all be the same too. Let's calculate the I12 product of inertia. So again, this is going to be an integral dm of, this will just be minus x1, x2. That's it. All right, so let's express our integral dm as something reasonable. So this is going to be minus the dense, and pull the minus sign out, minus the density. So this will be integral 0 to b dx3, integral 0 to b dx2, integral 0 to b dx1 of x1, x2. Okay, there's no x3 dependence, so let's just get that dx3 integral done. So you can just, if you want, you can interchange the orders of integration, evaluate, you get a b. So minus rho b, integral 0 to b dx2, integral 0 to b dx1, x1, x2. Okay, let's do the x1 integral, rho b, 0 to b, dx2. So we're going to get a x1 squared over 2, x2, evaluated 0 to b on the x1. So this is going to become b squared over 2, so this becomes minus rho b cubed over 2, integral 0 to b x2, so dx2 of x2. And that'll become x squared over 2 as well, so this will become minus rho b cubed over 2, and then this will be x2 squared over 2, evaluated 0 to b, becomes minus rho b to the fifth over 4. And then we can do the same trick as before and say that our I12 is equal to minus m over b cubed b to the fifth over 4. We finally get that I12 is equal to minus 1/4 mb squared, and you should convince yourself from the symmetry of the situation that's equal to I13, it's also equal to I23, and because the matrix is symmetric, that will also be equal to I21, I31, and I32. So, all of that having been done, we can write our moment of inertia tensor I as 2/3, -1/4, -1/4, -1/4, 2/3, -1/4, -1/4, 2/3, mv squared. So let's say we go ahead and spin our cube about x1. So going back and looking at our picture of the cube, we're going to spin it about this axis right here. So not about the center of mass, but about one of the edges. All right, so we'll go ahead and spin it about one of the edges. We'll say, alrighty then, L equals I dot omega. So that'll be mb squared, same bunch of numbers that I just wrote. It's a quarter, minus a quarter, oops, this is becoming awful. Minus a quarter, two thirds, minus a quarter, minus a quarter, minus a quarter, two thirds. And then our omega is just going to be omega 1 naught naught. Yay. So we get, well, we'll pick out a, doing the first row, we'll get a 2 thirds, and then a negative a quarter, negative a quarter, and everything else contributes 0. Mb squared omega 1. Let's think about that for a second. So if I go and write it using unit vector notation, L equals, just to help think about a little more, omega b squared omega mb squared omega 1. So we 2 thirds e1 hat plus, I'm sorry, minus a quarter e2 hat minus a quarter e3 hat. All right, think about that for a second. You should realize here that in this case, the angular momentum does not point along the angular velocity. At this point, you should be thinking, wait a minute, I've never seen anything like that before. And indeed, you're right. In lower division physics, when we introduce the moment of inertia, we always make sure our rotation axis is about what is called a principal axis about the origin. And we will get to that in the next video in this series. But for now, let me just justify where this sort of a thing is coming from before you think I'm totally bonkers. So let's put in, say, an XYZ coordinate system just to think about it. And so as we're doing our sum over masses here, so let's just look at a point mass, one point mass. And let's say it's orbiting about the z-axis like so, okay? So then right here, the velocity is tangent. And there is my position vector. So if you take the cross product has to be perpendicular to them both, you get that the angular momentum points like so, but we all know that the angular velocity points along the z-axis. So if you sat and thought about it carefully back in your lower division class, you would have realized that this was already happening. We usually just don't bother saying that much about it at that point, because for a lot of stuff, just looking at the principal axes is good enough. And like I say, that will be the subject of the next video.